basically what we do, we basically then maximize the magnitude of log likelihood. So there is a little conceptual difference. So you maximize the negative of the function, it's same as minimization of the function. So that's kind of it. So now we don't need to find, so now once we talk in terms of a minimization, we need to use an optimization method. That is what our objective is. Okay, so now we use gradient descent. I think this has been covered in the classes. So how does gradient descent work? So this is a typical cartoon example. We have two set of parameters, W1 and W2. Okay? And we want to find what W1 and W2 would minimize my function. Okay, there are many possible W1 and W2. There are infinitely many possibilities. W1 and W2 come from the real space. It can take any value. I want to find those W1 and W2 for which my cost is minimum. Each line shows the what is the height of the function, or if you evaluate the function with those W1 and W2, what is the function value would be taken. So let's say I have W1x plus W2x2. So if I give this W1 and W2 for a particular x1 and x2, this is the level. That's for level sets. So this is and then you see the magnitude, so it is higher, 13.5, 9, 6, 1.5, so it is gradually decreasing. So you might have seen bound, isn't it? Bound, like this. So these are the contours. You want to minimize the pumps of the reach. So we use this, this is for error surface, and this is a typical example, but we have lot of parameters, so our error surface may not be like this. It will be completely different. So how do we reach here? So what we do? Okay. So we don't know, we don't know where is the minimum point. We start with some theta, that is my initialization. If I take initialization here, now I need to move in the direction of minimum. Okay. So how do I move in the direction of minimum? How do I move? Any idea? If you compute gradient, what you will do? You will go around the gradient or opposed to the gradient. This when you want to move, you want to move around the gradient or opposite to the gradient. See, gradient points what our function, it points to tangent. Goes upward. Okay. So you want to go opposite to the gradient. That's what is called gradient descent. So we go negative direction of the gradient with respect to theta parameter, and then we do iteratively. We go one step, then next we evaluate. So it's called the iterative method for minimization. So it's coming from numerical analysis of the numerical methods we have studied in undergraduate and postgraduate. So we go into negative direction. So this is the gradient we are evaluating. So that's what derivative of total cost with respect to the parameters, which will give me the direction of ascent. I will go against the direction of ascent. So I will go into gradient descent direction. And we sometimes add theta. Theta is the learning rate. So learning rate means generally it is some real number. So if it is 1 means I am going in the direction with the same magnitude. So okay, vector points direction. Okay, so this is derivative of a function with respect to W1 and W2 would give me a vector. Okay. See, the C of theta is a scalar function, isn't it? C of theta is a function, scalar function, this is a single value, which is function of theta. So we will take a gradient of a function with respect to a vector. Okay. W1, W2 are the vector. Okay. So you get a vector. Okay. This is a vector. Vector has a magnitude and a direction. So we are going in the direction, along the direction, opposite to the direction. So and then when you theta multiply, so when you multiply a scalar with a vector, what it does? It doesn't change the direction of the vector. When you multiply scalar with a vector, what will happen? Direction would change or not? How many of you say no? How many say yes? So when you multiply scalar, it will not change direction. It will only scale the magnitude. So when I multiply, I will go very small step. So that will be control. So it doesn't change the direction, only change the magnitude of the vector. So that's what we do, and then finally after certain iteration we will reach to the minimum, and then once it is reached the minimum, what is the gradient value? So imagine now function is constant. What will be derivative? Okay. So there is no update in the weight. I did not talk to you about weight at best, but I will quickly talk. But actually what happens, we don't have function like the previous function. We always have a, you know, this kind of a local, many function, many variables are there. So you will not have a very complex function, you will have a non-convex function. So many times we use non-convex minimization methods. And imagine, here there are so many minima, okay? If you start here, you may end up in different minima. If you start here, you may end up in different minima. So you need to have a little more tricks and, you know, clever methods to come out of the local minima and find your solution. So there are many methods are there which actually people use to reach the global minima. But again, it's a little hard problem. It's not very easy. It's not very easy. There are many methods and maybe some empirical methods are adopted. But you know, one can, this is a research problem one can really work on. So different initial point would reach different minima. So what people generally do, so if you stuck into local minima, what they do? They try to push. So suppose I am stuck somewhere. If somebody pushed me out of that trench, I can go out and find another space. So that's called, you know, momentum technique. So what we do? So if you see, this is a ball, okay? And this is the cost, and the ball is thrown, okay? It will try to move the, towards the minimum because of gravity or something. Now what happens, this ball is rolling, okay? This is my parameter space, this is my cost, okay? Now what happens if this ball is stuck here, okay? This is called local minimum. You see that there is a global minimum just outside that thing. Here also, you set up point, you know what is set up point? There's a sum point, so basically there is a, let's say you invert this thing. You keep a ball here. So if you go here, it will go here, this side, and if you go here, it will go this side. So or it will be like this also. So here it is higher, it is low, but in this particular place there is gradient is zero. It's called plateau. Okay, there is a plateau in between. Again, there is a gradient is zero. So, if you don't have proper tricks, you may also end up into that place. So, gradient becomes zero, then go up there. So, some perturbation is required. So basically, what happens? The convergence of the algorithm would be very slow at the plateau and the saturated points. So we need to have methods to really come out. Okay, so this is actually really important thing. So this gradient becomes zero and then there is no trend, nothing is happening. So then the people use what momentum. Momentum means what? We actually come up with a this idea. We have a negative of the gradient. We add momentum, okay, to it. It will bring to some different location. Some additional factor we add. And then we move in the direction of the gradient, according to the gradient. And then whenever gradient becomes zero, this momentum term would actually add the extra gradient to the parameters, and it will try to go different location. And if you have enough momentum, it might actually even cross point, and then we actually can achieve the global minimum. So momentum is another kind of a trick by which we can overcome the local minimum. If this concept is clear, this is important. So you might see this momentum term, they use invariably in the simulation. So what is the meaning here? It actually pushes the the function or the variables to go out of the local minimum and find the best possible. It might happen and it might also it might not basically harm you much because you try to take a different location. Yeah, but again, there is no theoretical proof that momentum will always converge to an optimal limit. There is no theoretical proof. So, generally what happens, we have lot of training data. Lot of training data means, nowadays we have huge amount of data. And if you start computing gradient on every possible value and then update your gradient, you may end up, you know, using too many resources of your computer and you may not end up in good training as well. So, what people do that, they divide the data set into mini batches. We call that the mini batch learning. So mini batch means, let's say I have 10,000 examples, I will make a batch of 10 such batch and I will do the gradient computation on this 1000 batch, evaluate the error, then I will use the update from 1000 batch, apply over the next 1000 and so on and so forth. That's called mini batch training. So this is called mini batch, okay, that's what we do. So randomly resize theta, pick a first batch, compute the loss function, the cost. Update the parameter. Update the parameter means you have the initial parameter value minus the eta times gradient of the function with respect to all parameter, and then update it. Pick the next batch, again compute the cost, again update the parameter, and so on and so forth. So that's for mini batch training. And yeah, so again this cost is different when the parameters are different. So some people shuffle it. Okay? So the batch, so you have one time training you do, you pick some batch, okay? You next time you shuffle the batch and do the training again. So the neural network should not actually memorize things. So what we want, it should not memorize the thing, rather it should learn the behavior. So that's why we should make sure we do enough randomization so that it doesn't really, you know, like if you teach your kid A for apple, A for apple, you always say A for apple. So if you just show some other word, if you learn whatever you show me first, I will tell as apple. Then it's a problem, isn't it? So then if you show C to him, he will say apple. So it's kind of a little tricky. So you need to give enough randomization so that it doesn't memorize the thing. And then actually then theoretically prove also that the mini batch converges faster and then also give better training. Mini batch is very popular now. And also it is efficient because you cannot really load all possible data and then find the gradient for all possible values. It's not practical. So it is faster and then and when all the batches have been seen, that's for one epoch. That is the terminology used, epoch. And this you repeat every time. So several epochs will be required to finish one thing. So this is the basic idea of neural network training. Okay. Even deep learning is the same kind of idea. So if you have any question, I can answer. I will move to the CNN part. Randomly. You should have enough. So don't show all one at one time. You randomize your data so that you have all the possible classes in the one batch. That could be the idea. And sometimes it may happen that when you do randomization, one particular class will be more repeating than the other class. So you do enough time such operation so that can be utilized. But yeah, again, it may be biased because of the number of classes in one batch. It may be possible. No, theta is same. Parameter is the same for the network. Theta is the identical. Every time with one batch, we are updating the theta parameter. No. It's the same theta. So network has the same parameter. Only training data set will be converted into 5 batch. So I have 10,000 examples. I have converted to 10 batches. network has some, let's say, 1 million parameter. So first 1 million parameter would be updated by 1000 images. Whatever update I will get, I will change the parameter, give the next batch, again change, update the parameter, next batch, and so forth I will do, and then keep on doing till I get the very good error. I should try, but it's a random thing to do. It's a random thing, you can write a function. You need to write a function. If you use some library, they will do it automatically, but somebody should write it. So actually, all these libraries, they do automatically. But we should also know what they are doing. That is what I am saying. Mini batch is, most of the time we use mini batch. So imagine if you have 100,000 images. If you give that 100,000, even your memory of computer may not support that. So it's good to give it a smaller batch. So I will move towards the CNN and then I will quickly click CNN and then go to the other provider. That is not my lecture. So we understood why deep learning is required, because we want to learn the better features. So earlier we were doing it, we were using the either histogram or HOG or some kind of a gradient value, all those kind of things. So the conventional way, you give an image, you extract feature, you select feature, you do some classifier, learn it. So there are two different isolated processes. One is feature extraction, other is classifier. So people say if you want to have a better output, so it should be feature should be better or classifier should be better. So that's it. We don't know. So there are people working on classifier, there are people working on feature extraction. So any dumb classifier would give you better classification on the right possible feature. So all those questions were there. So what deep learning does, you give an image, it learns the feature and also classifies it. So that's kind of advantage. So this is all theory. I think I will not go into much detail. The composition of nonlinear transformation of the data. Goal, the learn useful representation, also known as features directly from the data. And it could be many varieties. We will see today unsupervised also, one of them is much better. And we will put, now I think in 15 minutes we will try to cover the convolutional neural network. So I think we have seen this thing. So what is supervised learning? We have an input X, we have a label Y, okay? And we have many training examples. So what we, classification problem, we give an image, we classify as a dog. For let's say regression problem, we can give an image with noise, it can remove the noise. Okay. Optical character function, we can give a text, we can generate what is the character. Okay. This is the black box we are learning. Okay. Typically we don't have any mathematical function which maps. Okay. That is what learning is possible. So you should only use neural network, where you don't know the mathematical function. If you know very good mathematical relation between input and output, no need to use this method. Suppose you know very good relation to pressure and temperature, there is no ambiguity, then you better use that method. Not only to use this neural. But so if you could be vigilant when to use, when to not use. So what in deep learning what we do? We just have layers of neural network. And then again do the same for problem this one. So deep learning is about learning feature representation in a compositional manner. This is very important. Compositional manner means, what is compositional manner? We are compositing one function over the other function like that. Okay, so that's the compositional manner. And the basic question remains, why learn feature? Why to learn feature? Why we want to learn? So let's say if you want to detect face, what feature we see? Yeah, human face. We see nose, texture of the material or whatever. If you want to see the chair and table, we have a different feature. So every time we have a different feature. So that's why there is a lot of work. So we should have some common way of generating feature so that we can compute the detectable feature. That is the basic idea. So basically we don't want that hand engineer feature. So let's say what this is a dog. So what we do, either we extract HOD feature, shift feature, color feature. Maybe HOD feature is very good at detecting humans, but they may not be very good at detecting objects like chairs and other. So if a new object comes, you want to find a new feature. That's the number of numbers. How do you choose which feature is good for which problem? So we should have a method to learn the feature. Given a problem, I should be able to learn the feature and then I should be able to use it for my purpose. So that is the basic question people are asking. So we don't want hand engineered features, rather we want to learn the feature. So what are the problems? So this is the conventional way. We do pre-processing, feature extraction, post-processing. Everything is very important. Any problem in any of the blocks will lead to a wrong classification. And there are very time consuming things, difficult to judge which is the best feature and what is the next feature set could be give for higher accuracy. We should keep, you know, so if you see the papers between 2008 to 2012, every time you have a new feature idea, you have a paper. And then every time new feature comes, then you have a new paper. So there is no, we don't know which feature to use for what. And so that's the question, can we learn feature from directly from data? So we have a thin image, I can learn the feature. So it is the best possible solution if it is possible to learn feature classifier together. So is it possible not only learn the feature but also learn the classifier? So softmax layer actually is the classification. So we want to develop an end-to-end recognition system. So what we do? So we combine multiple blocks. There are two ways one can combine the multiple blocks. You can take some of all this thing or one after the other composition. So mostly this is more useful to do. So like this is a, we have several functions. We generate a complicated function by combining this thing. So this is the problem. So we give a car, we learn, so we give an input image, we give a label, we learn the features. Okay. So this is called, you know, simple neural network learning. And we already seen this equation, wx plus b. Sometimes I use w transpose x, sometimes I use wx. So it is same, w transpose x. So we are multiplying one vector, two other. So if it is single thing, then we can have w times x. And this is the acquisition function. Okay. And then most of the popular choices. Now ReLU is very popular. I told you why ReLU is very popular. Why ReLU is very popular? Means it doesn't saturate. We always have a gradient. Always something to flow. Imagine our whole training depends on gradient flow. If gradient is not there, then nothing is being trained. Okay. So what is this thing? So we have a input, we give get output. Okay. So this is what we do. So we give input, we compute y level, we have a true level, we compute the error, and this is called forward propagation, and then we compute, you know, throw the error backwards. So this is called back propagation, again using gradient descent. Okay. This is what we have done, w is equal to w minus eta times. So sometimes I use C, sometimes I use L, loss and cost of the same thing. Sometimes for right L, sometimes C. But actually the gradient of the cost function is actually parameter. So now we need to understand how does CNN work. Okay, conversational neural network works. So imagine, okay, I have asked this question. Suppose we have 100 input neuron, okay, and 1000 middle layer we want. Total number of parameters are how much? 1000 times 100. Okay. So there are huge number of parameters. Okay. And this is little cumbersome. Because if you imagine, if you want to save this, if you want to approximate a function, So you might have learned regression, didn't you? You have learned regression? Regression you have learned, didn't you? Regression, all of you know. So if I have a more number of parameters to learn a simple function, what would happen? Overfitting. Okay, what is overfitting? So if I learn a simple function with lot a bigger polynomial, I tend to memorize it. So that's not a good kind of a trend. We want it to be, we should have a minimum number of parameters such that I don't overestimate something. Okay, that's a big problem in training. Underfitting and overfitting. There are different methods to avoid overfitting and underfitting. So most of the time what we do for avoiding overfitting, we want our weights to very close to zero. So most of the weights should be zero. That's for regularization. You might have none of the regularization. You restrict your weight to L1 norm. Okay, and then you want most of the weight to be zero so that you don't have too many parameters. So that's kind of one approach people do regularization. We will talk about convolutional neural network where we use the weight sharing concept. Weight sharing concept means we will not use the same kind of a weight connection, but rather weight will be shared locally with all possible locations. Okay, so now what we will do, come up with a stacking multiple layers of feature extractor. Low level layers extract local features, high level layers extract global features. And we have three very good components of the CNN. One is called convolutional layer, other is called non-linear layer, and third is called pooling layer. Okay, I will explain all these things. Convolutional layer, non-linear layer, and the pooling layer. So these are the building blocks of CNN. So what happens? We have an image, okay, input image. You see this box, which is I wrote as a W pair. W pair is a small weight matrix, okay, which is we call as a convolutional filter, which we traverse to all possible locations in the image. To take a patch, you rotate all possible levels and then do some convolution operation or rather correlation operation. Okay, so that we can say correlation. So what we do? We have an input image, we have a weight. We can always say that we can take the vector of the all possible filter. In the 3x3 filter, I can convert into a vector, and I can take 3x3 image again convert into a vector. So this will be W transpose X. Okay. And then I have a single scalar, and then I add also some kind of bias. So if it is bias over there, we can add bias. And this is the shared weight. So now this particular weight is being shared by many patches. Okay, so earlier what we have done, remember, we have converted the 16 by 16 image into a 256 cross one vector. Okay, and then we have another middle layer, which is every node from here is connected to every other node in the next layer. Okay, that is called fully connected layer. Now what we are doing, we are saying that particular weights is being shared by all possible pixels. Okay. That's called weight sharing concept. So this is called shared weight. Okay. And we do the convolution. So people use convolution as a name, but it's correlation. You multiply each element with the other filter value and then you add them. So once it's called convolution, so what will happen? So if I multiply or convolve a 3x3 filter with an image, what do you get? All of you receive computational background, isn't it? So if you convolve one function with another function, what will you get? So I have let's say sequence of 10 numbers. Okay? And I take one 3x1 vector. Okay? I convolve this with the sequence. What will you get? What is the length of the sequence? 1. Convolution all of you have done. Minus. So basically you get the, so I can do what? I can I can always do convolution multiple ways. Okay? I can say that you fix the output length to be same as the input length, okay, and truncate all others. So what you do, you take this kernel, multiply the three value, come up with another array, replace this sum of this value with the that thing, you shift this kernel, again multiply with three numbers, and then you do it so and so forth. Okay? So finally you have a length of 2 equal. Sometimes we use zero padding and all those things, no? Symmetric and all those things. So what we do, we convolve, so we will have another image. So when we convolve the filter with the image, I will get another image. Okay? And that's we call the convolutional map. So we call the convolutional map. And so then what we do? Then we apply non-linearity, activation. Okay, this is called activation function. It could be radio, it could be sigmoid, it could be anything. That is called non-linear state. And then we do pooling. So pooling is kind of downsampling. Downsampling is what? I take 2 by 2 pixel and in the next layer I will replace the maximum value of, let's say, 2 by 2 pixel with single pixel. So it's called kind of downsampling of the image. So if I have a 64 by 64 image, if I do 2 by 2 pooling, what should be my size? 32%. So all the 2 by 2 would be converted into 1. So that's the basic idea of convolutional neural network. So this is what we do. Okay. So basically, I think I will show like this. So this is the pooling operation. So what we do? So this is the input image. If you do the max pooling, this would be converted to some number. This would be converted to some number. Like that, it is downsampled version of the. That is called pooling. So you might remember. You know this stuff already? No. So this is called pooling. So it will down sample the image. There are advantages of pooling. Advantages are basically you can get a spatial, any small thing in the spatial thing can be recovered. It is very good spatial translation. Okay. So now we know this thing. So we know pooling and convolutional. So now what happens? We have I can use multiple filters. Why should I only use one filter? I can take an image, have another filter, give me another map, take another filter, I will give another map. Likewise, I can have multiple convolutional maps. Single image, I can have multiple filters. So this is what you know idea. So if you do layer wise, so this is one layer, I got one filter, non-layer stage. Give it all map, this is one layer, then I use this output again to the convolution operation, again got this some map, again to non-linearity, again to pooling, and then I can have the layer of architecture. Okay. I have one layer of signal, another layer of signal, and like that. Okay, so earlier we have this kind of a structure, now we have this kind of a structure. So what we do? So this is what we are getting. So we take a convolutional map. We convolve it, we get single pixel, and we do again and again, I will get a feature map. This is clear now. I am rolling over my map, I am generating all that one pixel, and I am getting this feature map. And if I use multiple filters, I will get the stack of feature maps. So this is one example, this is input image. If I take this as my filter, if I convolve this thing, I will get this is my one feature map. If I use another filter, I will get another feature map. So now, in the process of training, I want to learn these filters. I want to learn these filters. Keep ready. 5 minutes. So this is the process we want to learn. So we have input layer, we have a convolutional layer, we have a non-linearity layer, then we have a pooling layer, and this is one kind of a operation. And then we do again and again. And that's called CNN layer architecture. This is the non-linearity. So now, whatever convolution output is given to you, you apply ReLU function. You get the another set of map. And then you do a special pooling. What do you do special pooling? You take 2 by 2 map and then either do max pooling or average pooling or anything. And then you get a down-sampled version of the map. And that is the new input to the next layer. So we will stop here and then I think we will again touch on the thing. Basically multiple aggregation of composition of different layers. This we have seen already. So this I think we have seen. So how does it reduce the number of parameters? If you convert this image into vector, it will have if you have 1 billion different units, total number of parameters will be 1 billion. Only one single header layer. And 1000 by 1000, if you convert into vector, what is the number of elements in the vector? So many, isn't it? And times 1 billion header units. Those number of parameters. That's a huge. But if you use the 1000 by 1000 image, and if you use 1 million header units, and filter size is 10 by 10, I will only have 10 million parameters. So I have a drastic reduction in the number of parameters. And that we have already seen that if you have less number of parameters, training is better. But we want to go to it. So basically this summarization of convolutional layer, we have input image, convolutional layer, nonlinearity. Okay. So this is the simple architecture, layered architecture, very famous architecture. We have image, we have convolutional layer. I am using 6 such convolutional layers. Then we have down sampling. Okay, we have genetically some sample version of this thing. Okay, then again do convolutional. There are 60 such filters. Then again do some sampling. Then we converted all the output to a fully connected layer. Okay. So they use conversion of 2-dimensional array to 1-dimensional array. Okay. Invariably. So sometimes. So this is the final layer, is fully connected layer. All the nodes are connected to every other node. Yes. And then there are two such fully connected layers. And finally here, softmax layer, which is having 10 output. This is digit information problem. They wanted to predict the what is the digits. And this basically this is the idea. This is very famous paper, I think you can actually go to for more details. So this actually consists of everything. So we have input image, convolutional layer, nonlinearity layer, pooling layer, and then several components. But you can actually, I will share the code with the organizer. You can actually run on your machine also. So actually build. So I will share the two codes, one code for the simple neural network, other code for the convolutional neural network. You can practice on digit data, and then you should be able to train it properly, and then you can get the results. So I think I will not go into much detail of this thing, but maybe my practices. So this is the convolution. So what we are doing in the convolution, we are taking the map, rolling it over, multiplying, and generating map, output map. Then subsampling layer, we are downscaling this thing. And then we can use the depth information function to again train. Again we can define the loss. How do we define loss? True label minus predicted label. Sometimes people actually use cross entropy and all those categorization. So what is the recipe for learning? This is from there are very good videos on this deep learning and other by Andrew and other people. You can also listen to those lectures as well. So what we do, we design some network, okay? And if the network does very good in the training data set, then we should also check whether it works on the test data set or not. If it doesn't do good on the training data set, we change the network. Okay? And again, once the network is working very good on training data set, then we check on the test data set, and when it is working on test data set, then we are done. If it is not done, then either you need to add more data or change the data. Some kind of a hidden trial you need to do, and then once both the conditions are satisfied, you are done. Then it is ready to use. So training neural network is hard. That's not really very easy. You might end up in spending a lot of days in technology. It's not that I will build any network into the bar. Sometimes people do try anything. But it is not impossible. It's possible. So we can avoid overfitting, you know. And so I think I will stop here in the CNN part, and I will go to the unsupervised learning. Any question on this thing? I don't want to really go to the classroom supervision part, but since that could be able to do an exercise in CNN network, how do the classroom supervision work? Can you understand it? Do the derivation then come up with your own idea. But it's the same gradient descent only. Same gradient descent we apply to. Any doubt in this convolutional neural network in material process? What are the ideas here? What are the slides? There are some other slides. So this vanishing print from my code. It is not there. So if you have a smaller gradient, it is very slow. So most of the time if you see the neural network, you have the very high gradient in the output layer, and as and when you move towards the deeper layer, the gradient becomes small. Okay, so I think I will stop.